is the God Almighty is and the Lord Jesus Christ. It is not by our own ability that we stand here. It's not by our own option or our own zeal or anything, but it's by everything that He has afforded to us through the cross, through the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It says, and I want to thank my wife, thank you for being such a strong and such a tower and such a backbone for me. I'm telling you, I get weak out on that road. I get weak. And my wife just keeps telling me, Jesse, we got to believe. Jesse, we got to keep pressing forward. Jesse, we got to keep looking towards God, because He's the author and the finisher of our faith. He is everything that we need. And I want to thank her. I want to thank God. Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me saying, go and cry in the ears of Jerusalem, saying, thus saith the Lord, I remember thee, the kindness of thy youth, the love of thy espousals. That's a big word. I'm not a big word sayer, but espousals. When thou wentest after me in the wilderness, and the land that was not shown, Israel was holiness unto the Lord, and the first fruits of his increase. All that devour him shall offend. Evil shall come upon them, saith the Lord. Hear ye the word of the Lord, O house of Jacob, and all the families of the house of Israel. Thus saith the Lord, what iniquities hath your fathers found in me, that they are gone far from me, and have walked after vanities, and are become vain? Neither said they, where is the Lord? Thou brought us up out of the land of Egypt, that lead us unto through the wilderness, through a land of desert and of a pit, through a land of drought and of the shadows of death, through a land that no man passeth through and where no man dwelleth. And I brought you unto a plentiful country to eat the fruit thereof and the goodness thereof. But when ye entered, ye defiled my land and made mine inheritance an abomination. The priest said not, where is the Lord? And they had handled the law, knew me not. The pastors also transgressed against me, and the prophets prophesied by Baal, and walked after the things that did not profit. Wherefore I will yet plead with you. The Lord is always merciful. He's always gracious. He always deals with us. He always points us in the right direction. And He always there to fall, that we can fall on Him when we fail to go the right way. And with your children's children will I plead. For passed over the isles of Chittim and see, and send unto Kedar, and consider diligently, and see if there be such a thing. Hath a nation changed their gods? That's a question there. Where are yet no gods? But my people have changed their glory from that which doth not profit. Be astonished, O ye heavens, at this, and by heartily after afraid. Be ye very desolate, saith the Lord. Verse 13, I want y'all to read. I want y'all to check this and keep it in y'all's mind. Verse 13, for my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living water, and hewn them out cisterns. Broken cisterns that can hold no water. Let us pray. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, I come before you, Father God, the God of the whole universe, of the earth, of everything that is created and everything that has ever been created. And Father God, I ask you, Father God, that you would send down your anointing, Father God, that you would anoint this weary vessel, Father God, to bring forth the word that you have laid upon. Father God, it's not in my way and in my will, Father God, but it is in your way and your will, Father God. Father God, I'm asking you, Lord God, that you would take the love goal from the altar, Father God, and that you would touch it to my lips. For I'm in a people of unclean lips, Father God, and I pray, Father God, that this train would fill the temple once more, Father God, that you would bring us to an altar of holiness, Father God, that you would bring us to an altar of your will and your obedience, Father God. Father God, for we are a disobedient people. We have failed you in every way, Father God. But I'm praying, Father God, tonight that we would get a mind of you, Father God. That we would get a mind for your ways and your will, Father God. And that you would have your will made manifest in us and through us in Jesus Christ's mighty name. Amen and amen. Woo, y'all may be seated. Oh, I'm telling y'all, God's here. God's here and he's here and he's wanting to help people. He's wanting to bring us into his will and his way. Verse 13, I'm saying, for my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and hewn them out cisterns, broken cisterns that cannot hold water. What is God trying to tell us? We go back up to verse 9. Where he says, what if you will yet plead with you, saith the Lord, and with your children's children will I plead, for pass through the isles of Chittim. What is God telling his people? They have went the ways of the world. They have went through Chittim. They have went through everything that is of the world and everything. And they have tried to find God in all the ways of the world. They have tried to find God in the ways of music in the world. They have tried to find God in the ways of entertainment in the world. They have tried to find God in everything that is of the world. And he is not there. That's like Elijah. When he had to go to the cave of Anu. I'm telling you, Elijah, he could not find the Lord in the rocks, though they quaked and everything. He could not find the Lord in anything that is of this world. But he found God in that still small voice, which is God himself, which is God magnified in people, when he speaks to us through the prophecy of tongues and the interpretation. That is God's still small voice trying to tell his people, no, you can't find your ways in the world. No, you can't find your ways in Chittim. No, you cannot find your ways in Kinnar. No, you cannot find the ways that you need to go in anything of this world. But it was without holiness, no man shall see the world, the Lord. Holiness is the only way. It's holiness or hell. And I'm telling you, 30 years ago, they preached holiness or hell. And there's no other way. But I'm telling you, in this day and time, we want to preach love. We want to preach everything that is love. We want to have an everything and a banner and everything except then come to this church because we'll love you. We'll tell you every way you need to go. But they're telling you the ways of the world. They have preachers that'll crack over a Budweiser behind the pulpit and tell you it's okay to drink. You're going to go to heaven. No, you're not. You're going to go to hell because it says the drunkard shall not inherit the kingdom of heaven.
Yeah. Go on, man. Oh, hallelujah.
Lord, go and cry in the ears of Jerusalem. Where has the church? The church has lost its cry, people. The church has lost its cry. It's no longer crying in the ears of Israel. It's no longer crying in the ears of Jerusalem. It's no longer crying in the ears of America. We wonder why our founders and everything wrote the Declaration of Independence. It was to give us the liberty to go out into these highways and these hedges and compel them to come in. And without holiness, you're going to go to hell. That's what we have to tell them. We have to tell them, if you do not live your life by this word right here, you're going to go to hell. There's no other way. It is hell. It's holiness or hell. Do we know God? Do we know God's will? Do we know God's will for our life? Do we know God, what he wants for our life? God wants us to live holy. God wants us to live righteousness. God wants us to be a witness to him on every aspect of our life. That's what God wants.
Amen.
We're getting them to an altar. I told Brother Robbie this morning in Sunday school. We're getting them to the altar, but we're failing to get them to Jesus. We're failing to get them to holiness. We're failing to get them to God's word and God's way. Brother Lenore raised because Jesus is the one that changes them. Jesus is the one that brings them to holiness. Jesus is the one that brings them into the ways that they should live. But we sit up here, we want to say you got to have your dress this long. You got to have your shirt up to here. If we would get them to Jesus, we wouldn't have to preach that. Because Jesus would show them how they need to dress. Jesus would show them how they need to live. Jesus would show them that they can't watch that garbage on TV. Jesus will get them and show them that they can't go to the movie. Jesus will get them and show them that they can't have the pleasures of this life.
Yeah, amen.
If we get them to Jesus, He would take care of everything else.
Yes.
We want to know why God ain't moving and manifesting Himself in this day and time. Because we're more worried about putting our name on it instead of His name on it. Do we know God? Because if we knew God, if we knew Him, and He was the one that saved us, He was the one that transformed us, we would not be worried about what we think or what our abilities are, but we'd be worried about what He wants for our life and what He desires for our life. Yes, we need to go to school. Yes, we need to get an education. Yes, we need certain things in this world to be able to survive, such as clothes, such as money to pay your bills and everything. But God said that He will not forsake a sparrow. And look at how small it is in the creation. And it wants for nothing daily. Don't you think He can provide for your needs according to His riches and glory?
That's right, amen. Come on, bro.
But we don't want, and I'm struggling with this right now. Well, I think I'm preaching to myself, really, y'all. Because I'm going to tell you, I struggle with this right now. I'm scared to death to quit my job. Even though God has told me to quit my job. Because I'm afraid that I won't be able to provide for my family. I won't be able to put food on the table. I won't be able to take the worry off of my wife. I won't be able to provide. But I'm telling you, God is able to provide. God is able to provide according to His riches on glory. He owns a cattle on a thousand hills. You think if you're hungry, He won't slaughter one of them cows and give you some meat for your belly?
Oh.
But Jesus was 40 days and 40 nights on the backside of the wilderness, and the devil come to Him and said, oh, turn these rocks into bread.
Come on.
And God said, what did Jesus say? Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. God can turn, He turned the two fishes and five loaves into being able to feed 5,000 men, not counting women and children. Yeah. Don't you think He can provide for you?
Amen.
Don't you think He can provide for your bills? Don't you think He can provide for everything? But we don't know God because we can't have faith in Him. It says the just shall live by faith, not by the sight. But if we had faith and we knew who He was and we believed in Him, we would be able to understand and believe and trust His word. There's some 34,000 promises in this word of God right here. And every one of them is afforded to us. But yet we fail to believe Him for our healing. We fail to believe Him for our finances. We fail to believe Him for every aspect of our life. We even fail to believe Him for the salvation of our lost loved ones. That's why they're not getting saved. Because we don't believe when we pray that it can change that evil drunkard into a man of God once more. That's why he's not seeing. That's why we're not seeing the manifestation of the Holy Ghost in this last day. Because we are failing to believe God's work because we do not know God.
Yeah, come on, man. Glory. Praise God.
We need holiness. It says Israel was holiness unto the Lord and the first fruits of His increase. See, we're not meant for second class. We're not meant for second rate. We're meant for the first fruits of His increase. We're meant for everything that Jesus Christ afforded to us on the cross. We sit here and we hang this cross on the wall. But do we really know what it gave to us? What it afforded?